Good evening. Welcome to the April 7th Selectmen's Meeting.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We're going to start the meeting with a selection of conversation about the Selectmen's 2015 goals. And I was thinking that we would each just take, you know, go in order and talk what our first goal, you know, is, so that we don't all repeat the same one. Is that okay with everybody? Everyone okay with that?
Yes, sir.
Okay. My goal is that I think is most, not most important, but very important, that I'd like to see us work on is roads and infrastructure. Particularly, we have a new director, and I would like to see, why don't you join us, Chris, up at the table? I just noticed you have a front row seat.
Everybody's sat
Is anybody else here? Is anyone else here with you from your department?
No.
Okay. Well, I, you know, that's the goal that I'd like to bring to the table, is roads and infrastructure, and I'm hoping that maybe we could commit to something that people can actually see. You know, maybe a three-year plan.
Well, I would agree with you.
Do you think a five-year plan is too far to...
No. No. But we should be... Understand that in that 5 years, something may happen. In my experience, you could have one road deteriorate faster than another. So while you might lay out, let's say, 20 roads over a five-year plan, you have to be somewhat flexible that a certain road could fall apart on you. It's happened to me before, where I had a plan in another community, and yet half a mile of road, literally, when the frost came out of the ground, it fell apart. And we had to basically take what money we had delegated to other roads, mill that particular road up, and repave it. So with all these things, like my drainage projects, my sewer projects, and the road projects, I think it's great to have a plan, have a five-year goal, but then just understand that it's a guide plan, if you will, and that there needs to be some flexibility in it based upon what may happen in that time period.
Well, that's one reason why I thought maybe a three-year plan might be better, is because at least there's people sitting here at this table that are going to be here for 3 years, and they might, you know, work towards the completion of the goal.
Right.
And as we all know, that it's really a 20-year plan, because it's going to have to be happening forever.
Well, definitely. Right. It's just ongoing. And yeah, and at the end of 20 years, you're going to look back and say the ones we did in 2015, these, you know, hopefully we'll have crack sealed them or done some other temporary patching in between, but you'll be going back and looking at some of those roads, especially the ones where there's either been a lot of truck traffic on or development off of, side streets. So one can't predict how that's going to play out. Therefore, you don't really know how each street's going to last. Or
how are you facing, now that winter's coming to an end, are you facing extra challenges that you would face in other years?
Yeah, in that with the more snow came more water. But the other thing is, in a week and a half, it changed from sub-freezing temperatures to above 32 temperatures, and a lot of moisture in the pavement. It all delaminated the upper layers. A number of people called, and it was like, I think they thought that we were literally going to, like, drop the shovels and run over to the paving plant. And that's not literally how it happens. So I think the first week we were putting in gravel, but now we're we're back to actually patching those, but we're still finding that pavement temperature isn't up there high enough for those patches to last, so some of them have been temporary patches. And the paving plan didn't open up until this week, so you really can't, you couldn't up until this point buy permanent paving. We were just using cold patch and what we call mirror mix, which is a more expensive mix.
So questions about this year's DPW? We want to start the discussion, Rusty?
I think you're right. We need to have 3 years, probably a good way to start, but obviously it's 5 years is more down the road, or easily 10 years, 15 years. We've got to start looking towards the future. You know, we've got projects coming in. I know we've got the drainage on High Street that we're looking at, but there's other areas too that we can't forget. And I think to keep our public better informed, we need to do a better job at selling it. I think we have an opportunity with Channel 22 and with our internet and all that, that when we talk about infrastructure and how bad it is, I know you've got a lot of video of pipes that are terrible, and when you talk to people on the street, they say, well, we don't see that part of it. Well, I think we need to be able to come up with some programs where we can show them some part of that so they can see what the actual problem is, and I think if they see it, they will better understand it.
Giselle. What do you think? Mrs. Wesley?
I'm going to go to number two on my list because...
Let's go with this discussion.
That's what my number two is.
Okay.
Because my number one was remove access to town property by drug, but that went out the window, so that's off. Number two, of course, is Public Works. We need a staffing review, particularly in the highways, for we simply have too few men to do the job, and the men who are there are not getting any younger, and it's taking a terrible toll on them physically. I think we really need to take a hard look at what we're doing with the highway crew. Next one on my list for Public Works is ventilation in the wastewater treatment plant. Do you remember the most recent proposal or workup, Chris, for redoing the ventilation system?
There was... under that $1.385 million bond issue a couple of years ago, not only did it tackle dewatering, but it also tasked us with doing what they call odor control plans.
Right.
And GHD developed a phase one and a phase two odor control study.
Yeah.
Basically two levels of implementation.
Mm-hmm.
Serious money.
Yes.
In the short term, I know Mike Dewey has put in the CIP portion that he gave about $20,000 to handle or replace some of the air handling units in the building. So they'd like to tackle that first, and that's actually in the plan that I'll be submitting to the town manager.
In addition to serious money, it's a serious health risk for the employees over there. Rolling stock, and at some point in time, you know, it's my goal to get together and have the board get together with you and review all the rolling stock and start paring down and organizing and getting all of the vehicles that the town owns beaten into shape. Washdown shed, and that's high on my list, hopefully, for next year. And then not just the roads, but that's a staggering proposition at this point. They're all in terrible shape. The shoulders of the road and the sidewalks. And we've been carrying the sidewalk money in the budget for years and haven't even used it. I'm not advocating constructing new sidewalks. I'm not a great fan of sidewalks. You have to plow them and do all kinds of exciting things to them. But at least sealing them to prevent the deterioration which has already taken place. So that's what I'm looking at, the big things for your department for the coming year.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director, it's April 7th. It's Alexander Bean's birthday, and it's your first day as Director of Public Works. Can we have a round of applause?
Welcome to the board.
Alex has built the ratings from you.
Okay.
And it's great to have somebody from Wilton on board down here.
Thank you.
You're an accomplished professional. Mr. Welch has briefed a synopsis of your career highlights, and we're glad to have you aboard. The center of gravity here is line 4312 in the town financial report. 2014 actual, there was $375,000 spent on drugs. Not going to get you much. There was a proposal for Exeter Road. There were $2 million plus in soft costs that got kicked back. We're going to do $300 million. Mr. Welch is on that. You know, the numbers that general government is $8.3 million. That includes insurances. Public safety, to include fire, police, building code, is $7.6 million. Your department's $5 million. However, 2014 is $375,000 actual. To have a committed project list, it needs to pass the budget committee, it needs to be articulated, it needs to be forcefully presented and articulately presented by you with some professionals, working with one of the greatest town managers around. But if you're not spending the money, then the roads aren't going to get better. It's no mystery. So it's not a surprise, and we're looking forward to that coming from the department. That you lead, in my opinion, to Mr. Welch, to the selectmen, of $375,000, and if you went back and you went back and you went back year end and year end and year end, you will find no commitment of taxpayer dollars to infrastructures on the roads, and that's why they look the way they do. And everyone says, we've got to do the roads, we've got to do the roads, we have to pay for the roads.
Yeah.
And that's the simple solution. So, you're the department head, welcome aboard, and back to you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Mr. Waddell.
Thank you. It's always fun to be last, low man in the totem pole, you know. I don't know. But, you know, last night we had the acting fire chief in here, and he made some good points that all of us need to think about, and that's being proactive rather than reactive. And so often I think the selectmen are reactive rather than proactive. And I think we don't take into consideration our department heads enough, and that the expertise and the goals actually come from the department heads. I mean, we can set the broad goal of roads and infrastructure, but how we go about it, you know, we have professionals who are going to help us to develop that goal on getting there effectively. You know, I think with the roads, we have to decide whether it's a budget issue or a bond issue. You know, we're at some point going to say we're going to bond and take care of a lot of roads at one time, which is important. But I think, welcome aboard. I know you'll do a good job, and we're all going to become more proactive, and we're all going to trust our department heads more than I think we have in the past.
See, he's the perfect closer. I think what's really most important is that we, like everyone said pretty much, about we need more money for your department, and we need to make sure that the public's got a lot of faith in your plan. And that will be, I think, you mentioned about the whether it's going to be a bonded issue or whatever. We, you know, we've got to have a plan that's visible and something that we can sell to the voters.
Right.
And so, any other questions regarding my first goal? Hey, yeah.
Not just a matter of money. It's a matter of where we are spending the money. And in this department, we need to check on staffing. We need to bring on younger individuals who can learn the town like the older guys do and give us the extra muscle that we need and the extra manpower. We are three men in a highway crew, and the town of Hampton is outrageous. There's no excuse.
Like, you know, it's his first day on the job, and he's rebuilding the department for the future.
He's
sure
tough. He's tough.
He's got some ideas, and we're looking forward to hearing them. So thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Rydell, did you want to?
Well, one of my goals that I wanted to look at is economic development for Hampton. We have an area on the railroad tracks. That there's a lot that can be done in that area. Downtown. We have an area down there, but it's going to be over 4 or 5 years. What are we going to do? What are we going to do about parking downtown? What are we going to do about that area that the tracks is once the state takes that over? I think we actually need to have some sort of a committee that deals with that area. and deals with the economic development of downtown. I think we could...
Planning issue.
Well, it is a planning issue, but it's not just planning, it's economic development. Yeah. And I think if we had somebody that was working on economic development...
Why don't we have our town planner join us at
sure.
the table?
Yeah, we also.
Uh-huh.
I think we're probably all set with you, Chris.
Thank you, Chris.
You're right. He may want to stick around and hear some of the other things.
Good evening, Jason.
Hello.
Hey, Jason, how are you?
Very good, thanks.
And I probably should have brought this up to you beforehand, but I didn't. I think we have, the opportunity is going to be showing itself with what goes on downtown, the railroad tracks. We have a couple of organizations in town. We have Experience Hampton. We have the, what's the beach?
HBAC.
HBAC. You know, we have a lot of these groups that are out there that are looking at doing different stuff. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to have some planning and some work brought in together to bring that in. You know, it was kind of by accident that we got Smutty Nose here. Smutty Nose is a very good neighbor, very good for the community. We need to, encourage more of that. And I think we may need some help more than what you can give us.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. And certainly the downtown area has been on my radar since I got here. I know that before I got here, you created a town center district with the Town Center Historic North and South Zone yeah. districts. That core, the historic, is really very critical to having, a vibrant downtown. You have a lot of things in place right now, but there's opportunities perhaps with that back area you're talking about in terms of maybe a rail trail. I know that RPC has been looking at issues like that. Parking in the downtown, obviously. You want to also look at walkability issues, make it more pedestrian-friendly. A lot of people are going out in their the bicycles, places to accommodate bicycles. Just make it a whole vibrant area. People want to take their families and everything for lunch somewhere, go to the shops down there. And I just think it's very, very important. I mean, you have some of that going on seasonally at Hampton Beach, but obviously your downtown is a very critical part of any community, I believe, in my experience as a planner. And I think there's great opportunity there right now. It's just a matter of making it happen. And I do think economic development is also an important component of that. Perhaps, grants that might be available out there, somebody seeking grants to help us to accomplish those things.
I think it's out there. You look at communities like, or even Exeter now has somebody doing economic development, mm-hmm. but you look at Dover and Portsmouth and these other areas that have kind of rehashed their downtown area, and they've really got them pretty going pretty nice. And,
yeah.
and we've struggled here for a number of years. A lot of it has to do with infrastructure, too. I mean, a lot of our drainage runs down through the railroad into Subto.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of our, and stuff like that. But we have to start thinking proactive and how we can get about doing that. And how do we go about that? Do we have another committee? What would be a good way to look at starting that?
Experience Hampton is an organization that considers that. I think that's a good place to start and to look at that. Perhaps it does involve the creation of another committee that looks at downtown specifically. That is very possible. One of my suggestions, I provided some goals here that I, for my department anyway, and one of the things that I was thinking about is starting an advisory zoning review subcommittee. I mean, I know you just established zoning for that area, but to take up, to look at areas such as down at the beach or other areas of town, and perhaps, there's something there that committee could do should that committee be formed. So, but I do also think that independently looking at issues like economic development and pedestrian, transportation, multimodal transportation and so forth, I think is very critical to that area. Certainly something I want to look into.
And Jason has been attending the HBAC meetings, and you're going to be doing that on a regular basis.
Correct.
Yeah, and I wanted to say that what you just said about, I don't even know when it was, but it was some time ago, when we worked on the master plan for the downtown area, because I wanted to be on the one at the beach, but I ended up on the one uptown, and we, I don't know if you were here then, Fred, or not, but we had it in, like, up at the Inn of Hampton, or...
It was before I arrived.
It was before you arrived. And that was one of the biggest comments, what you mentioned about people want to go downtown, families would like a place to walk with their kids or something. And, you know, it would be good for everybody's business and for the vitality of the town, and I think that's what Rusty's.
Absolutely. We have that whole corridor that's just sitting there right now, and I could see that as a bike path or a walking path, and in tying the parking areas off of that, so it would encourage people to go downtown and use the downtown area.
But that might be a great springboard for that, for the revitalization of the downtown.
Absolutely.
Well, I believe.
Absolutely.
And I know that from being on the planning board, we also discussed when we had, about having like a mini, an overlay for like Exeter Road.
Yes.
For the Montrone properties that exist. Is that 100 acres or 200 acres?
I don't know the exact number, but you're right in the ballpark, the overall property. It is.
Yeah. I believe.
And that's part of actually, when I just briefly mentioned the zoning review subcommittee, that was one of the things that was going to come under that. Looking at the zoning and best uses for that area, that's something that I'm going to present to the planning board next week to consider creating that committee, in fact.
Yeah, Jason has been very impressive. He jumped right in when you come to town, and it sounds, I know that you've brought some new vitality to the planning board, that's for sure. What would you like to talk say about
this?
Actually,
next on my list is the panel on the planning board. I think we need to clarify the requirements and change some of our zoning ordinances to meet modern needs. I think we're still back in time on some of these things. I think we need much more explicit clarification on septic systems, and Jason and I have discussed that, and I believe he's done a review. The riverine wetland delineations now, not just wetlands in the marsh, but along the river, so we have substantial property values along the river. The Taylor River Bridge and the Underwood Bridge, yep. Both of whom probably will never be done in our lifetime, but those are both critical accesses. Public versus private roads, and I want to discuss this with the board at some point in time. I'm not going to bore you now, but I have a problem with Fred and I were kicking this around a few days ago, and he said it might be smart to wait 2 years to see how everything settles in before the board makes a determination, because this board does determine whether a road is going to be public or private. I have a problem with that, because I think a public or a private road doesn't.
We're talking about
should go on when the plan is being finished and finalized. So, and my last item under the planner is the much of our remaining land to be developed includes a lot of wetlands. I would like to see the planning board aim for trying to, for example, the Dingman Montrone property, get a donation of conservation land as they are authorized to develop whatever project they have going. So kind of a tit for tat, trying to bring the conservation land so we're not stripping everything in the community. That's it.
Very good.
And you're a very patient man. It's nice to talk to you.
Mr. Bean.
And
we're talking about economic development in downtown, maybe.
Great, thank you very much. Good evening, sir. We've spoken and spoken with our leadership in the town and folks down in the area where this zoning change might or might not happen. There's interest on the private side and perhaps on the public side, on the southwest side of Ashwood Avenue, to do some zoning change from residential to business seasonal, but perhaps you can contribute in that effort going forward. For economic development, the state took the beach and the depression on the front side. The boulevard's locked up. The west side is very North Carolina-esque. It's beautiful. It's the equivalent of the room in Rattleboro. There's extensive room for development. Those that do have the residential zoning right now, many of those are non-conforming uses. They're trapped. They're trapped into a position without equity.
Now, what area exactly are you talking?
On the southwest side of Ashwell Drive. It's business seasonal, and then right down as you head towards the bridge on the right in the marina, it's residential. It's been that way forever. It seems to be inconsistent. And then when you look at the market price and the real estate sales and the development, those that have properties that are in the business seasonal accrue more wealth and have a higher purchase price. I think there's equity that's trapped in that zoning platform. The Hinton Marina is an interesting exposure. There's a tiny spot for Hinton residents at North Beach. We have limited access. Again, the boulevard is tapped out. That might be something interesting for the town to look at for numbers to pursue and consistent with changing for residential to business season. So that's something that might pique development down there. Certainly, the planning board and developers have done a magnificent job in conjunction with infrastructure commitments by the town to the tune of $40 million in conjunction with the state, and no one can argue with the success of that. So those are some of the broad economic development schemes that we might work on. If they're not approved by the board, then they'd be private or citizen petition warrant articles to that effect.
Yeah, and I think, again, to bring up the Zoning Review Subcommittee, I think that's a great opportunity. The Zoning Review Subcommittee that I'm going to present to the Planning Board that idea, I think looking at the Montrone properties and looking at that on that same committee, I think rather than forming multiple committees to look at zoning from one, you know, look at them case by case, do that, and then other things are going to come up over time, so you don't have to dissolve the committee and keep it active. Issues, so it certainly would be something I'd like to look at as part of that process.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Jason.
Mr. Waddle.
Thank you. Jason's obviously good at his job and patient because he comes from Western Mass. That's where I lived for 30 years, so that's a positive. Economic development, I think that's a great idea. I think the more revenue we can bring into town, the more it helps to keep the tax base down for the taxpayers, the individual taxpayers. I think there's probably been a lot, if you went back through the notes and minutes from past years, there's probably been a lot of plans that have come up, and I think it's the selectmen's job to work with any committees and any departments and to keep a positive attitude on the development and to keep it moving ahead. And that's what I have.
Thank you. And I think that, you know, you're another department that, you know, you're just starting out and you're new, and there's certainly room. I know the Planning Board is looking forward to working with you and making the whole process a lot stronger.
Likewise as well.
Great. Thank you. Mrs. Wesley?
We're all set. Now, the only other thing I'd like to see the Planning Board discussing, and I know they'll never do it, is impact fees with Iowa Development, if you're talking economic development.
Now, what about your goal that you'd like to suggest?
I went through my whole list, if you wanted to go through it again, but that will probably be very painful.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you. Mr. Bean?
Regarding?
What would your goal that you'd like to bring to the table tonight?
For selectmen's goals?
Yes.
I did a bunch last week, and I don't want to be repetitive. We talked about the zoning. We talked about infrastructure need. We have spoken with the town of attorney on HB 616, Chapter 53. We have $19 million in the piggy bank. We have roads that can't be driven on that are an embarrassment. We have warrant language prepared last year. We didn't get that up to the forefront. We have $4 million in our undesignated fund balance, give or take. These are round numbers, but $19 million is in our trustees account. The way that law is written now, and not to be repetitive or redundant, is we have to pay commercial rates for to borrow our own money while our roads suffer, while we have dire infrastructure needs. That needs to be amended. This is a law that is specific to Hampton. We don't need to kiss the ring of other legislators as if we've attempted to do it and conquered unsuccessfully the last couple of years. We could use substantial portions, millions and millions and millions of dollars, to our own benefit. Simply take an asset from a bank account and turn it into an asset of a super high quality road that would entice further development and put the spit shine on the town that it needs. So that would be a real key goal for us to do. That is an imperative.
You're going one by one.
Yeah, let me just kind of think out loud here for a second while we do that. And then finance, if you look at page And if you go to the annual report and you go to page 141, well, that's 2013, but if you look at the bond schedule, we're running a couple million bucks a year in bond payments, including principal and interest, for the next, till 2028. So that's where we're at. We're kind of tapped out. We've got $19 million sitting in the bank. We're paying $2 million a year if you study well, and we get input from the finance director. It's not brain surgery. We have the money. We have the need. And we just come and have that teamwork, put that together, get the warrant, improve the roads, and do the development. Thank you.
Mr. Waddell.
Thank you. Thank you. I guess one of my goals this year would be in the aspects of town employees. I think we have a lot of very valuable employees in town. Every year we can present a budget and stuff, and we talk about salaries of the different employees and stuff. And I think it's incumbent upon the selectmen to show to the town the value of our employees and the value that should be reflected in what they're paid and how they're treated. And I think that's a very, very important goal for us to have. And not to compare them to other towns, but to show that what they bring to the table, you know, and have the town realize that. And I think it's more in Rusty's alluded to it, you know, in social media and everything else, and getting it out there, what people do, what the different departments do, what the different employees do. And what their value is to the town, and have the town realize that, and realize that some of them are underpaid and they need to go up. And I think that's a goal that we should do. Another goal that I have, and I'm going to go with two,
yes,
since I'm at the end.
Please do.
Go ahead. Is for the different boards to work more cooperatively together, and not have a sort of banging heads together, which oftentimes happens, that one board trying to tell another board what to do. I think that if we're elected boards, you know, we each have a position that we're supposed to be taking. I think the cooperative working makes the working of the town better. So those are two of my goals that I have. And are we going to hear from different departments?
Yeah, that's what I was going to suggest. This is that's sort right. of like an untried, we weren't sure how this was
going to work. Because I was sitting there thinking they got off the hook and they didn't
leave. I thought we would ask each department head to, but...
You want to go next in line? Yeah, the fire was on my list next.
Okay, here, I just asked you.
No, but I thought we were still doing
okay.
Planning.
Okay, well, now, why don't you bring your goals?
Well, I have a big concern about staffing in the fire department. Huge concern. Thank you, Jason.
You're welcome.
Good evening, Chief.
Good evening.
And,
everybody is joining me again. Good
morning. I'm very heartened by the refreshment in the... fire prevention office. That was wonderful last night. I'm very impressed. But you have staffing needs that you need to fulfill in your department. Also, the fire contracts will likely be coming up again next year. And that's another thing for your department that we're going to have to take a look at. I have the same concern in fire as I have in public works and police. And that is we have older long-term employees working like oxen in the fields, and then the oxen will drop dead and probably nobody cares, but we are really physically stressing out employees in this community because basically they're carrying in effect a double workload, especially during these storms this winter. When you have crews out there and you have men were hurt and working hurt and on call 24 hours a day for X number of days in a row, we're going to have to do better than we have been doing about addressing staffing needs and what we're doing with employees, including not poisoning them with the air handling system at the wastewater treatment plant. So I would certainly look forward to working with you gentlemen. We've got to get off the dime and start addressing the needs of your department.
Okay, Mr. Bridle.
I'd like to hear what some of your ideas for staffing and manpower.
That's a leading question.
Well, I know it is a leading question.
From the guy who knows, you know.
Nah, from the guy. I obviously feel I know what you need. You obviously have your own ideas of what you need. I think you're doing a pretty good job right now.
Well, thank you.
I really do. I think with all the trials and tribulations that you've been through over this past 6 months, you two gentlemen have done an excellent job with the department.
Thank you.
We did see, you had your presentation last night on fire prevention. Are we still looking at replacing the fire prevention off the inspector?
The inspector's position?
Yeah.
Absolutely. We're still looking to fill that. It's a necessary position.
Yes.
As we discussed last night, you know, we've taken a new role. One of the things that I will present, and I introduced Ms. Stephanie Welsh last night, I feel that she's more valuable than I can actually express to you right now to what we've done in implemented change. I would like to see her become a full-time employee. I think that it's warranted, and I think that my business office will be well supported by her being there. So I'm going to present that as time moves on. I also feel that it's extremely important that I can't base the growth or the department on a person. I want to base it on an idea, on a structure. Mm-hmm. So, you know, God forbid somebody decides they're going to take a job somewhere else, they're going to get hit by a bus, you know, again, knock wood, God forbid that happens. I can't have the entire department fall down because that person's irreplaceable and now gone. So I'm trying to develop it so that the system will absorb whatever it might need to. In that, we've eliminated a lot of the stovepipe relationships there, where one person who has the knowledge is the only person who has the knowledge, and I flattened out the organization to a great degree. We've been dealing with significant radio issues, as an example, and instead of one person knowing what's going on with the radios, we now have Deputy Kennedy's been dealing with it, Captain Cutting, we've had Captain Stevens, myself. We have a lot more players who are knowing what's going on so that the cogs are still moving, even if one person is out. So we're trying to flatten out the organization a little bit to make that work. As far as staffing goes, and I do appreciate what you're saying, right now there are six people out surgical. One is out injured, pending results, but we have six people out surgical. They're out for a long time because of that, and most of them are injuries on work.
Yeah.
You know, you don't have to look hard and wide to find that the American population is growing, and they're not growing up. They're growing out. The CDC tells us that, you know, obesity is a great problem. Our firefighters are carrying people down two and three flights of stairs in a chair. This is not easy work when you're lifting them up if they're in a stretcher. We're dealing with 5-inch supply line hose. This is all heavy, heavy equipment. And we're seeing injuries from it. And, you know, ma'am, I think you touched on it. You know, we're certainly aging. We're not 22 years old. We have one firefighter that was, that's probably, I think he's 23 now. So, you know, God bless. I think I graduated college and he wasn't playing it. But in that respect, we do have an aging firefighter population, and we have significant injuries. This is a result of that. We try to distribute the workload as much as possible, but at the end of the day, these guys are out there day and night in the storms, and they have the potential to be injured. I would like to see staffing come up. I really would. First, I'd like to see my people healthy, and then I'd like to see them there. So currently, we come down to 8 for staffing. I would like to see our minimum stay at 9, potentially moving on to 10. Mr. Welch had asked for the capital improvement plan moving forward for the next 5 years, and he really, at the time, he sold it to me. He said, listen, you need a ladder at the beach. And I said, I don't disagree. So I went home and I did the research, did due diligence on it. Well, you know what? That's going to take staff. We can't just put a ladder at the beach and it's going to be an expensive mm-hmm. pull rack,
yes.
You know, just like everybody's treadmills at home.
Yeah.
So in order to do that appropriately, we're cross-staffing now. We have an ambulance at 141 to Connaught. We have an engine. We have a ladder. Well, we don't have more firefighters to run them. We cross staff.
Yeah.
The same would be the case there. Previously, there were 2 ladders in town, and there were ambulances being run cross staff. I envision that again. As I discussed, this is probably 2 months ago now, I talked about what happened in 2014 where we broke records.
Mm-hmm.
We're now on pace to break a record again.
Yeah.
Last week, we ran the numbers for EMS, and we were 22 calls above last year's numbers at the same time. We're outpacing our record year. So I anticipate that this growth will continue, and at some point, doing more with less is not possible. So I will entertain that for sure.
You're right.
Yeah. Does that help?
That was awesome. Thank you.
Questions, Mr. Bean, for the acting chief and the deputy?
Yeah, gentlemen, great job in your departments. Appreciate your brief last night on enforcement to regulations and getting businesses stood up. Great response on that. Going forward, there's money in this town, there's money in this state, and it's dropping everywhere. But to the people in need, middle-class taxpayers, small business owners, and government employees, and it creates a challenge. We have to be maneuver-minded to do that, and we have to work together. And I think we can accomplish it. And I think it's great that the chairman and the town manager and that you folks are in here tonight. But there's $23 million in the piggy bank. And the state...
Happy to take it off your hands, sir.
States, the state's... the state in the balance sheet here, in the income statement, they give us no money. The line is zero. We contribute quite a bit. We've had those discussions. But we'll all work together. And we'll all get it done. We'll look at need. And we're going to stay happy. We're going to stay motivated. We're going to stay cohesive. We appreciate your leadership. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, and Mr. Waddell.
Well, you know, staffing, I think it's an education process for the public and for the voters and for the taxpayers, you know. They have to know that they're getting the value out of the fire department. They have to know what the fire department's needs are. And they have to know they're being protected. And I think that's an education thing. And I think just take one shot at Max. The newspaper never helps when they're always publishing those top salaries and stuff, and then making it look like everybody's making millions of dollars.
Well,
I think you have to counteract that in your education.
Part of that, I think, sir, and I think that you hit the nail on the head for sure. Some of those top salaries, you have, if you think about by math, the people who are earning the top salaries, they're rarely home. They have families too, and they're exceeding the time at work.
Yeah.
Over time, you know, and one of the things that we're extremely, you know, impressing upon at least ourselves and our families is that family is first, period. Everything else will work out. It's hard to say that when you're working 80 hours a week. You know, there's just not enough time. And if you imagine, I understand that we work 24-hour schedules in the fire department, not us, but the firefighters are working 24-hour schedules. That's 48 hours a week missing from the family. And then they'll come back for callback, they'll come back at night, and, you know, Selectman Bible can attest to this. When you work a 24-hour shift, especially if you're getting 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 calls after midnight, that next day, your family doesn't want you there, you know? So there's a lot that goes into that. Those salaries, they're representative of people who are really putting in a lot of hours.
And that's education. The taxpayer has to know that.
And the other education part of that is the fact that those guys aren't asking for that all the time.
Sure.
We're asking them to do that.
Yeah.
And there's a reason, because our call goes on call. Absolutely. Absolutely. The other side of that as well, but I would like to point out, and I think that it couldn't go more hand in hand than what you said, Mr. Waddell, is that with the education and staffing and potential for a ladder trouble, whatever it is, if we look to the growth of the town, we're not growing 1 and 2 family cottages anymore. We're growing 5-story buildings. There's a lot of real estate there to cover. They're code compliant, they have sprinklers, they have fire department connections. But you know what? As people move into town, that's a lot of people that need services as well. So with the services, with inspectional services alone, it's going to take a long time.
Thank you. And I think it's another case of he's jumped in and there's a lot of he's got a lot of good ideas. And
I've had great support.
That's right. For a long time.
Oh.
How long have you been with the department?
30 years.
Yeah, so that's what makes it work, is some new people and making sure the old people, we learn from
you. Some of the old officers.
I don't mean old people. I mean, you've learned a lot in the last 30 years. Experience is a great thing.
I've learned a lot in the last 6 months.
I'm learning more every day. But thank you for coming in tonight. So I think we're probably finished with these guys.
Thank you.
Well, does anyone else think, before we move on to talking with the department heads, does anyone else have a goal that wasn't mentioned?
I have a couple left, if you can stand it. The parking and enforcement seminar that we're going to hold with Route 1A, Boar's Head, North Beach residents, I still have that in mind. We need to do that.
Why don't we bring the police chief and the deputy? If we have you come up now, we'll hear from your department, and she's just brought it up anyway.
She's been talking to the chief and Deputy Nilo, I'm sure. We need to get a grip on enforcement at that beach this summer. I mean, I'm tired of having people call up, and I agree with you and with them.
To be honest, ma'am,
stop that parking.
People are, I don't care what we do, people are going to call and complain.
about the park issue.
Well, I don't mind the calling so much. They can call me all I want, but it's not being able to get the vehicles through.
And we're talking up on the North Shore, just so I'm...
Yeah, well, the numbered streets and Boar's Head, and Fred and I have been kicking around a little bit, maybe permit parking or something on someplace like Boar's Head.
Well,
and people dumping trash all over the place. The people who own property up there deserve some respect, and I'd really like to see somebody mean in your department.
Okay, let's discuss that issue that you just brought up. Yeah. Do you want to address her issue that she just brought up?
Let me discuss the parking issue up on the North Shore, particularly the numbered streets. Those streets are particularly narrow, and as you go up there now, you go onto some of the streets, you are parking on both sides of the road, with 19th Street's the only one that's restricted.
Yeah.
I pulled up there where you can't fit a car up when cars are parked on either side of the road opposite each other. You can't move.
Yeah.
So that's definitely an issue that's got to be addressed. One of the other issues we have to address, similar to when we had the infrastructure project on along Ashworth Ave, where a lot of people have reached out on the town rights of way and put obstructions to those parking areas, and we really need to get a clear delineation of what's actually a driveway and what somebody paved over their lawn. And now people don't know where they can park.
Jason can maybe help you with that.
It's a significant issue down there because there's a limited amount of parking available. I've heard suggestions such as making permit parking, similar to what Seabrook Beach does on their beach. It's permit parking only for residents.
Yeah.
Those are things we can consider, but I think you probably need to get some input from the folks that live up in the area because that's a growing area of permanent residents, but a lot of people that use those properties seasonally.
Yeah.
And getting some input from them, maybe holding some type of public forum on that topic before we start going down the road of what changes are going to be.
Do you think that's an area that is that the most dire area in Hampton, or are there other areas that you have more concerns?
As far as parking, I'm very concerned up there because if I can't fit my cruisers down that street, then fire apparatus is not going to be able to get down there if we have a serious structure fire or somebody needs medical assistance.
Yeah.
That is definitely something we need to look at. But I think before we go down that path, we should get some input from the public. Something has to be done. But it's going to be palatable to the public also. I mean, I've heard one-sided parking, similar to what we have at the main beach, ranging to permit parking only.
Yeah.
You know, just keep in mind it is going to impact a few of the businesses.
Yeah.
We have a number of businesses down there, not a lot, but it's going to impact them, so maybe some input from them, too.
I think Fred's been drafting a letter already.
Here, April 20th.
I was planning on it.
So, well, that bill will make that some type of public forum where we would invite input from the people that are there, the players, are in that area.
I just don't want us to forget it.
Okay. This is what we're going to discuss.
Yeah.
We want to give everyone a chance to talk about it.
And the other thing on my list for police is the contract.
Okay. And do you have comments, Mr. Bean?
Yeah, I do, and it just goes to our board in particular. It goes to leadership. We talk about tight budgets. We talk about what we do for the state, and we're still providing services while we charge people in town for services, ambulances, and we tax people for services, we charge for services. The state gets a free pass, and we've been unsuccessful in our legislative agenda. We are policing our state property, and not just at the beach, but up on the highways. We are providing fire protection. We're providing municipal services unreimbursed while we charge Hampton citizens. And until we address that at this board, in my opinion, and until we address that, giving away of Hampton taxpayer money to people that take $0.2 billion from the 103042 voters will not take any requests for more money seriously. And we're watching, they're listening, they're standing by, and it's been going on for 3 years. And it's got to come from the bottom up. And the notion that we can do more with less is simply false. We've heard from the fire chief tonight, so that we can't do more with less, but we continue to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on state property. So I think that's a key issue, and I don't think taxpayers and voters take us seriously until we start addressing that. But not in a disruptive way, but in open communication to the state and saying, you have your $60 million liquor stores, you've got your $60 million tolls, and we police them, we provide fire protection, but we're not going to do it anymore. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Waddell, talking about the North Beach, do you have some comments?
Yes. I agree with what you said. I think the public discourse is great, and I think it'll go. And super.
I think you get good attendance on it.
Yeah.
Just in, I hang around up there at the local coffee shop there, and it's always a topic of discussion, those parking issues, and what we could possibly do about it. So,
yeah, okay. I'm fine.
So questions for, do you have any further, Rusty?
No, I think we'll work on it. I think he's got a good proposal.
And Mrs. Wolseley has another point she wants to make.
Two more things quickly. The Hampton Handbook, which we went over with Mr. Diener last night, updating the Hampton Handbook. And also, the last one on my list is reviewing with our committee's procedures for them and what they should do and not do. That's it.
Okay, so thanks, gentlemen, for coming in tonight.
Thank you.
I guess we'll pick on another department. Thank you. Thank you for your suggestions. Donna, did you want to... come up here. We're going to invite everybody just to come in.
So we'll start with you.
I see you there, and I'm sure you want to go home.
I don't really have any goals for my department. My department goals were met last year when I got my full-time employee.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm so thankful for that.
So just fill us in. Everything's going great.
Everything's
at your department.
Going great, yeah. In fact, I heard today from a customer on the phone who said every time she calls this town, that we all, every department, are the nicest town that they've ever talked to. So it speaks to the employees that we have in this town, and I'd hate to see anybody go anywhere because of money. But I will say that the people that I work with, we're all like a family. I work with the best group of people I've ever worked with in my life. So I'm so happy to be here with them.
Mr. Barlow, would you like to?
No, I think she does an excellent job, and I think she brings in the most money around here, so so she does an excellent job at it, and continue to do good work.
Thank you.
Mrs. Wolseley?
Great job. I'm rounding the digits off in the calculations.
Yeah, we're going to see how that goes.
That is a good idea.
Yeah, I think it's a good idea.
Mr. Bean?
No, sir. Thank you. Great department. Great work. Thank you.
Mr. Waddell?
Keep bringing the money in.
I will. I'll do my best.
Thank you. And let's see. She's... what about... What?
Diana?
Yes. I can't see her.
Diana's hiding.
She's hiding
back there.
Yeah. Hey, Christy's sitting there with her head down.
I'm watching.
Hi, Diana.
Hi there.
So, would you like to give us some of your goals for this year?
I guess our department, too, is maxed out on what we can do with the amount of staff that we have in the facilities that we have. In fact, one of the things that's becoming a problem for us is that Tuck Field has become year-round. Of course, we'll take this winter out. It's been a hard winter, but it's becoming year-round. People are trying to, I've been saying it for years, people are trying to get on the playgrounds during the middle of the winter and stuff like that, so... Currently, right now, our parks department is very, very, very low staffed, like beyond the point of not being able to get stuff done now. So I need to do some movement with the park staff and hopefully get some more park staff. And I definitely need one park person year-round at this point. It's become a problem with the way the insurance is going with the Obamacare, that the people that I have running the show, I'm going to be able to do some of the hours that they could last year, and I have no more money to hire anyone else new. So, and it's nice to have that one person that I can depend on every single day down there at the parks. We use the Tuck building year-round now, so we need someone that's down there maintaining that as well. So I would like to see a few changes with especially that department. The other departments are running pretty well. The parking... parking too, though I need to do something with the salaries in both all of the departments, I'd say, except with the lifeguards. The parking has become a longer season too. When I first hired Victor DeMarco, his job was from June 15th to Seafood Festival, and now it's become March through November, and it's a little bit, there's less things going on those months, but it's getting longer and longer, and more things are coming in. So in the next few years, things are going to have to change there as well. One thing that is on my list here that I'm hoping to talk with you about at some point is the Westport Hotel. I think that's a nice opportunity for us to expand the parking for senior citizens. But I think expanding the parking down there, ideal. It's a great opportunity for the town if we could acquire that piece of property.
Have you looked at that piece of property?
I'm going to go look at that piece of property. I've not looked at it yet.
Why don't you go and look at it and try to figure out how many spaces would be possible there? I mean, we're looking at the money that was just voted down at the beach for 75 spaces as a reference. And they feel that they are going to be successful with that 75 spaces that they're getting. Do you think there would be 75 spaces?
There may be even more than
that. Close.
Because that actually borders the parking that's already there, right?
Yes.
So that helps make even more spaces.
That's right.
Well, so it would be if you sort of did a study for your department and brought that to us so that we could really realize what the possibilities might be.
Yeah, I was just directed today to go and actually see the facility itself.
Mm-hmm. So.
And then, of course, on my big screen, I would like to eventually see something with the seniors or community center, and I know that's not going to happen tomorrow, but I'd like to at least start something rolling, even if it's just a committee again to help figure out like what we want to do in the town. Again, we don't have enough facility space in this town for everybody. We served 8,000 or 9,000 people last year, and we see people every single day. We're in the business of people and quality of life, and we serve so many people, thousands on the parks, that it's time for something for especially the seniors.
Do you think this is the time for a committee? Like, there was a very active committee that worked for how many years?
We've had two committees, actually, and we had a very active one that we had for probably 3 years, and a couple of those people are still interested in being a part of it.
Is it? Have you talked to the schools at all? I know they're looking at their addition over there, and part of their addition, they've talked extensively about community schooling, and so community schooling would also have community space for our community, as in seniors or other rooms, or making that space so it's used for both things.
Right.
And I think they're looking at drawing up plans this year. So I think now is an important time to get with them and work on that committee.
Yep.
And do I think if people see more multi-use space out of one building where we can use it for a couple of things, I think the public is going to be more in tune to looking at that.
I agree with you. And my original idea before I knew the school had some things that they wanted to do at the junior high was to partner with the library and possibly put something together where the old town hall and the courthouse used to be, because the library also does need to expand, and we do serve a lot of the same people in the library and in the rec department, so it would be a nice win-win for both of those. And we actually did go meet with Kathy from the junior high school, the SAU. I'm blanking on her last name right
Murphy.
Now. Thank you. Kathleen Murphy. Last year we met with her and discussed with her.
I think it's time to get back with her, because I know they are working on it, and they're getting that committee up and running, and I know they want to look at that.
Yep.
So I think
that's
all part of planning and all part of the community together, and I think it's going to work.
Yeah, because again, they're all the same users as well.
Correct.
Yeah.
Hey, Mrs. Wellesley, questions for the recreation? Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Director. Great job. It was part of that Westport Motel, if you will, draw or plan out. I'd be interested in when we have the surge for the Seafood Festival, we have transportation from high school and our junior high facilities, the center school. We have problems with parking. We have congestion, and I'm not convinced that more parking is an answer to economic development and increased happiness at the beach. And if there was some mechanism to replicate or duplicate the experience at the Seafood Festival where there is a trolley system that transports people to the beach from uptown and alleviates some of the traffic, alleviates some of the congestion, alleviates some of the policing that goes on with vehicles and the limited space that's there. And love to hear your thoughts on that west side going forward, what the light department could do with the marina if in fact that ever did reach fruition. But I would like to hear Plan B on getting people to the beach and back to the beach if that in fact was a recreation department function. Thank you.
Mr. Waddell, comments and questions?
Thank you. Thank you. Quality of life, I mean, that's really important for town. I mean, and, you know, your department does really well. I mean, you work with the inexperienced and the experienced, not the old, the experienced people.
Yes.
And the mature people.
Yes.
And working with the schools, I think, is very important to do that, develop the community. And I think it's you know, other people, there are so many people that use the parks and recreation. So many.
Thousands.
And they need to support it more. Mm-hmm. And also, you know, maybe a little bit more social media for the parks and recreation, that you're out there, you know, you're just slapping people out of what you're doing, because you are doing so much,
mm-hmm.
so often. So I think you're doing a great job, and I think we need to, you know, help you do a better, help you to continue to do a good job and help you to get the support.
Thank you.
And any other, thank you. I'm glad you, I'm sure you're really ready to go home tonight. You've probably been
yes,
working hard.
Yes, I haven't been home yet.
Thank you.
All right.
Well, I wanted to tell you, that is the King Bowling Alley.
Oh, it is?
I checked it out, yeah, when I went the last time.
Perfect, good to know.
Okay.
I'm going to try and staff that up. Another program.
Yeah, thank you.
Yep.
Why don't we bring up Kevin from the building department?
There we go. Let's pick on Kevin.
Yeah.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening. Is Jason still back there? Jason, why don't you come up and sit here with Kevin, too? We're kind of similar departments.
Similar. I'm trying to go hand in hand.
Yes.
So I didn't really prepare any goals. I didn't know that we were going to be doing that. I guess the first thing that comes to mind is to survive.
Yeah.
This next year.
You have a very busy department. Why don't you tell us about that?
It is. It's very busy, and all you got to do is take a ride around town, and you can see a lot of construction, and some of the stuff that's coming down the pipeline that's getting ready to break ground, it's going to be a very busy season again this year. So, the same as Deputy Chief Ayer said, I looked at our March report up to this point, the first quarter, and we're ahead of last year.
Yeah.
And last year was like the third busiest year since I've been here, 15 years.
The third busiest year?
Yep. So, and we're ahead of that.
Well, it seems like some comments were made about the zoning and that, and Kevin's certainly works close with the zoning board.
And I have been working with Kevin
yep.
in terms of our zoning ordinance right. and updates, and, you know, I have a lot of past expertise in zoning. He's got a lot of direct expertise in New Hampshire, and I think that it's working out well.
Well, this last year, some of the amendments we did, we worked close together on
yep.
those as well.
We did.
And I think that's been mentioned here at the table tonight about working together, and these are two departments, you know, each by representing a different board, but yet what they do is very similar. You know,
yeah, Jason's been a big plus with the planning department to work with and get involved and stuff like that. So
Kevin may not be new, but he's always been a star employee.
I don't know about that, but
well, your department's always it's a moneymaker, isn't it?
It is. It is, and last year, like I said, I think it was the second or the third busiest as far as. Permitting and inspections and stuff like that, and as well as generating revenue through permitting, permit fees and stuff like that, income. So, yeah. And by the looks of things, I think this year is going to surpass last year, and it's on that road. And I think we got two pre-construction meetings
yep.
for two very large projects. Yeah, the contractors are chomping on the bit to get going on. I just issued the demolition permit for 3133 Ocean Boulevard, the old Harris Real Estate.
Yeah.
All those cabins will be gone end of day tomorrow.
Oh,
in preparation for a very large project there. You know, and all you got to do is, you know, you can see what's going on where the old surf used to be, and you got one kind of rural, you got new subdivisions going in, and there's building everywhere. The Chuck Rages project, and
Have you noticed the results of having the new was it the lady's name at the fire department?
Was that
Stephanie Welch?
Stephanie Welch having a secretary there.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, that's been being very helpful lately. I am corresponding with her with emails back and forth, and yes, so that's starting to work out.
A lot of synergies.
Because they have someone there, and I've been working close with Jamie Aylott as well on some of these things, bringing him up to speed with some of these projects and what he can expect. So I've had several meetings with the deputy chief over the last couple of weeks on some of these projects, and Stephanie's been involved with those as well. So that, it's all good. It's all good.
It's going. It's getting better by the day.
It is getting better. It is getting better. I got to tell you that. Just in the last, I can just tell you in the last couple of months with the fire department, the communication, things like that, and as well with planning over this last year has been a big step forward.
Mr. Bridle, questions and comments?
No, I think he does a good job.
For either gentleman? No.
Either one, nope.
Good job on the permits, et cetera, but we're still losing a lot of money that could be devoted to infrastructure if we had established impact fees. School impact fees, nice, and I'm sure the school appreciates it, but we've missed a huge, with the building you're talking about, we're missing huge opportunities for impact fees for the community.
I know I worked with the former planner, Jennifer, if you remember her.
Yes.
And when we created the first impact fee for the school, it's a lot of work, and you got to be very careful with that.
Right.
And it's got to be designated to certain, you know, expenditures, like the schools, or whether it be for DPW only, or PD, whatever it might be, recreation, sewer.
Police.
So you got to write those carefully, and a lot of thoughts got to go into that. And you got to be careful too, because you don't want to fee yourself out of development. Does that make sense?
No.
Okay. I mean, you don't want to make it so difficult or expensive to, you know, that
to
discourage
both sides of the issue.
Yeah. I think when we were doing the research on that school impact fee, we took a field trip over to Londonderry because they had quite an impact fee system in place. Mm-hmm. And I think there was either 6 or possibly 7 different impact fees they had. And it did affect them to the point where I believe they've revamped that whole system over there as far as the impact fees went. But it was pretty extensive. So it's a good thing, but I think I just caution that it's going to be well thought out.
Yeah,
I think you would agree with that.
I would, and I was going to say that it's on my list of planning goals actually as a discussion worth having anyway, to see if there is any room for expanding that or not, you know, to see how people feel about that.
We missed an opportunity on municipal infrastructure. We will get no impact fees for the police station, no impact fees for the 2 fire stations, no impact fees for the Church Street pump station. Yeah. All of that stuff is already built, and we can't back tax. So we've missed a fairly.
Yeah, we're looking for the future.
I've been sitting here and people have been looking at the future, and the future just comes.
This is our goals for us coming here and their goals that we're talking about.
Yeah, there's other ways you can look at that. I know just last June, I finally came in and amended my permit fee schedule. Yeah. And that one June 1st.
And it's something you've done many times.
Well,
last few years.
We went quite a few years before.
Yeah. But I mean, it's something you're always looking at. I've heard you discuss it a lot.
And doing some comparisons and looking around comparable communities and stuff like that. But and that definitely made a difference. So we're grabbing some of that money from these developers and these projects and stuff. My understanding, the fire department's just made some adjustments to theirs. So that's another step. I know DPW has done some adjustments.
I was going to add, too, that, you know, we're starting to look into that as well. Lori's been doing some research on that, and I'm going to jump in on that and look at our fees and seeing what we can do in terms
and
of...
And it's good, like Kevin said, to look at other towns, what they've done, what's been successful.
I know she has been, and I'm going to be jumping in on that. She's a good resource, too.
Comparable towns and activity in that, and you find out that you're, like, way behind the curve or something like that. You really want to get up to speed with stuff like that.
Comments, Mr. Bean?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Schultz, you're a long and valuable tenured employee here, and as department heads and leadership has transitioned, you have become one of the bulls. And I know you're a young man to earn that title, but you have earned it, and you run a very, very important platform. And in many instances, you're one of the few town officials that folks will bump into. And you do a magnificent job. When you go to your website, you look at the process that you lay out on your website and the description. It leads to an ease of process. I thank you. I know the board does and the community does for your assistance that you're rendering to Chief Ola as they transition into that. And I know they're looking to you for that. I know there's no extra pay for you to provide learned counsel. But please understand that the board appreciates and the town appreciates your work and your department's work very much.
That's my pleasure. I appreciate that very much.
Okay.
Comments and questions?
I'm sorry.
And Jason's just chomping at the bit, I think, to say something more, aren't you?
No. Well, we talked about a number of goals. I've actually ended up mentioning a number of them in our two discussions here prior to that. Is there anything else that you
think
in particular?
I would just like to say this is kind of new. This meeting tonight?
It's new for us. There was absolutely
no. I find it very interesting. I think it's very helpful. I think it's good. It's a good thing. I can't remember in the 15 years plus I've been here, something like this. I think once, maybe 10 or 12 years ago, there was a kind of like a get-together with the department heads and the selectmen.
I can remember doing it also.
You remember that?
Yes.
And it was more like a venting thing. Mm-hmm. It was like, just talk to us. You know, what are your thoughts? What are your needs? What are you happy with? What are you unhappy with? That kind of went, we got a little heated, but it was pretty interesting thing, so. As far as the goals from the selectmen, and Mr. Waddell's primary goal, I'm 100% behind you on that. I will support that.
Well, I think that we're going to take a look. We're all listening tonight, and we're going to take a look, and we'll come down with maybe a list of goals. Maybe Fred can decipher it.
We're working.
I've been writing them down here. But thank you very much for coming in tonight, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Christy, why don't you join us? There's the woman that controls all the money, and money seems to be a problem. What about your department? Well, you're another person that's fairly new to your department.
It'll almost be 1 year.
Almost 1 year?
Almost 1 year. I'm in the last month, April 30th, May 1st. Ah. So my top goal that I just wrote down when I was sitting back there, Mr. Waddell will like it a lot, it's talk slow.
Good deal.
Is what? Yeah.
Talk slow. He always complains I talk too fast. The only thing I really jotted down today is improvements I would like to make to the budget and the budget process. And Fred and I have talked a little bit about it. I talked to Mr. Bridle and he bounced some ideas off and had suggested that I contact the school and get some input on how they present their budget to the budget committee and to other presentations that they do on it. I think that the more details seem to be the biggest thing that I heard from many people and stuff, so I think I'd like to come up with a little bit of maybe some restructuring of how the budget looks in the books and how it's presented to the budget committee and to the taxpayers of the town. So that's basically all I had. Since IT falls under me, Paul had come up and spoken with me yesterday, I believe, when he heard that we were going to have this meeting. And the only thing he wanted to share is he had two goals, and 365 Live, he would like to lay the groundwork for that. That's something that will have some financial impacts I don't remember exactly. He and I had talked about it going into this year, and then when we ended up with the default budget, I pushed him away on that topic. But that's something that we will probably come forward with when we bring our budget forward in October. And then the other one that he is looking at is upgrading the gateway firewall. So something about his firewall. I cannot give you many details on either one of those things, but I do know that 365 is something has to do with Windows and the cloud and the way that the computers are going in the future. And so he is looking at that and looking into that. So I think when we come to the budget process, that will probably be something that we do bring forward at that time.
Questions and comments for Christy?
No, I talked to Christy a little bit about some stuff, but I think it's, like you said, it's going to be how we present it and how we let the voters know what it is. And I think if we can do a better job at selling it, because I don't think our budget was that far off. I think we did a lousy job selling it collectively. So I think if we can get to the voters and explain to them why, and tell them why, and show them why, then I think that's going to be. And you, as you said, that's one of your goals this year for yourself. So.
Questions and comments?
The school budget presentations have been excellent, but they're doing a single interest.
Right.
Those PowerPoint presentations that they put up are marvelous, and it'd be kind of difficult to do, I would think, with the breadth of the town budget. But it's good that you're thinking and getting proactive and figuring out new ways to do stuff, Christy. Thank you.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Director, and congratulations as you near your first year of directorship. I had said in prior meetings the compensated absences, that is starting to develop a temperature. It's well over seven figures and it's growing. We have aging folks that could punch level any time. We as leadership, don't require that be funded and identified in any profession. Well, you did a great job with GASB this last year. This is a financial report. It is a note in the audit, but we have well over seven figures that we have no official game plan on how to do that, and that's just not professional. Again, we have $23 million in the bank, and we need to do a better job on that and forecasting that. I think that is an imperative goal. I think that will continue to rise on the auditor's report. And I don't think any of us are satisfied with how that's going. Additionally, when we talk about our services on the state going forward in the collaborative, what does it cost for us to provide those services in-house in terms of depreciation? GASB exists for a reason, with our assets, with our employees, with our operational costs. How should we provide services? And if you were to contract for police and fire to protect two huge physical plants on 95, and what it costs this town to provide the fire stations for that. And we know when we look at our bonded amounts that those were $5 million last year. And if we depreciate those at a simple 5% a year, what that costs. And those are real costs, and the state gets those for free. We don't identify those, so we can't go to the voters. And when we don't develop those metrics, then nobody moves to that decision point that, yes, it costs us this much to provide that service, and we're not going to do it anymore. And we simply say that. Not at the main beach, where our boundaries are so close, but up the back border, certainly Exeter, certainly Seabrook, certainly Northampton could provide responses just as well. Or the state, as they cut back local aid and continue to mandate that we comply with regulations, they can take care of their own property. So I see that as an issue going forward. Finally, if you look at our bonding going through the town report and the financials, if we look at what it costs to do $7 million of roads and we factor that in and we get that information, Mr. Bartle talks about educating the public. We do a very poor job of doing that. If we say we need $8 million of roads done, well, in 2013 we did $5 million for fire stations. We know how that bonded performance looks. We know how that affects future amounts in terms of interest and capital. And so if we can get that information, identify it through other department heads, these are the costs, this is what it's going to look like on this page that's out of the financial report, I think that's an easy sell. And we're not doing that. And I think that should be a future goal. And then people respond to that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Director.
questions and comments, Mr. Wardell?
Thanks for that first go. Works well. Yeah, I agree with Leslie on the budget. We do a great job with the spreadsheet, you know, in putting everything out there. But I think a lot of people are visual, and I think more graphs and things like that on the budget, and more the percentage the budget goes to this, that, and the other thing. I think that's all important. But I think a lot of it's presentation, and I think we can do a better job on presentation. And I think it's up to us to help you do that. But you do a great job, and super.
Thank you.
Yeah. And she always has candy in her office, so that's a positive.
Yeah, I think that, you know, it's been a while since we had, I know that on other boards that I was on, we did do some studies on the mutual aid and, you know, what Hampton gives out and what Hampton, you know, what are the other towns, what are we receiving from the other towns? And I don't think we've discussed that for quite a while. So maybe that's something that we need to review, too. But thank you for coming in tonight. We appreciate it. And I think we've heard some interesting comments here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Why don't we have Jamie? Is Jamie still here? Yeah, Jamie and Mark Gerald join us at the table.
Good evening.
Good evening. Would you like to give us some of your goals?
Sure. I've been in the back writing furiously as you've developed yours, and I think one of mine would be to synthesize those for you as the manager and set up a task list so that we can go about accomplishing those. Well, I've had a number of things that I've talked to the manager about, some assignments I've received and things that I've been directed to do. Obviously, the big one, there was a discussion about that wage salary study, so that'll be a big goal for me this year. And again, I've got a number of things, drafting job descriptions, being involved, at least in my own development, within, you know, areas outside of what I'm experienced in the town. So I'm spending a lot of time learning about public works, roads. I've got a visit coming up with the wastewater treatment plant, you know, things like that for my own continued development. But there are a number of other operational things that friends give me assignments for that we'll stay very busy with. Happy to answer any questions.
Okay, and questions for Mr. Sullivan. Mrs. Woolsey?
No, we're glad we have you.
Thank you.
Mr. Bean?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Assistant Town Manager, again, it's just so nice to have you on board. I think that I know that you contribute to an improvement synergy, and you're just a real great force multiplier in your step to the right department, the legal department. You wear two hats as personnel and working with Mr. Welch, and it is a very noticeable difference, so we appreciate it. And then as we've talked about all these, you're just going to be that added resource to coalesce that effort and move ahead with these goals, and we're just very, very happy to have you aboard. Thank you.
And Mr. Wardell?
Yeah, same deal. And I think the board has seen the value of the position that you moved into. I think we've seen that in a bunch of management decisions and things that have gone on and some of the help that you've given the board. So I think it's been a real positive, and I think it's worked out well.
Yeah, I think that that's, I know that all the members of the board have seen the value of having you here. And, you know, having had you, how many years were you at the police department? 31 years, and now you're still here, and you're bringing a lot of value. And, you know, you've heard a lot of things here tonight that give you some idea of where we're going to be working for the future.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Could I just say about that? The nearest person to me, office-wise, last fall was the first time in a number of years where we've had a collective bargaining team that was strictly in-house and spearheaded by the assistant town manager. And I think it's universally felt that that process was the most productive of any in many years. And there was not time, frankly, to acquaint the voters with everything that was involved in that, and the two contracts that were very well done did not pass, but may pass in future with more voter education. There were not just monetary items involved in that, but a number of other provisions that were not simply wage-oriented, but for the benefit of the town, all of which were negotiated by the assistant manager. We did not use outside counsel, saved a lot of money on that, and frankly, we were able to better coordinate being as close as we are than having someone come in on the outside. And as I say, the process from the employee's standpoint seemed to go much better. We'll have more contracts this year, and I think with more time that can be dedicated to it in the course of the year, the voters will have a much better appreciation for the product that they're seeing than was able to have been accomplished this year.
So do you feel like you learned, looking at the results from the voters this year, for what you, you know, got some direction of where you want to head for next?
I think we do.
Discussions.
I think had the voters had a chance to be more time to be better acquainted with the things that the employees were giving to the town in terms of those provisions, there would have been a greater appreciation for the product. Mm-hmm. It wasn't just the dollars and cents of raises.
Yeah,
it was a lot more to it than that. And as Mr. Bean has said, the synergy involved, the positive synergy, can't be underrated at all. That was a lot of good was created with that, and I think will carry over into future negotiations.
Comments or questions, Mr. Bible?
Mrs.
Wesley?
Yeah, well, I've been looking, what I was looking forward to this evening, well, it's been productive, but I'd like to see us consult with these two gentlemen on our guidelines for the functioning of committees, selectmen committees.
We're going to be talking about the committees as soon as we're finished.
But I'm hoping we can get some type of guidance or a draft from these gentlemen as to standardizing what we expect from the committees that are appointed by this board.
Yeah, so I guess you gentlemen are going to be a integral part of the discussion that's going to follow after we're finished with all the department heads. Mr. Bean?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yeah, just briefly, we touched on at least one board member and perhaps had some acquiescence, but in terms of rezoning, in terms of the draft warrant language for the $19 million and working with finance, both of you developing that and working closely. Now that Jamie's on board and you have hit a nice battle with him, that will be very, very constructive. And if perchance the board does not go forward with that, it will be professionally developed. So if there was citizen interest in a citizen warrant petition article, if that can move forward and be allowed to be presented to the voters. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mark.
And Mr. Waddell.
That's right now.
Okay. So are there any other department heads we haven't heard from here?
May I give you a couple of other goals
please
that involve other departments?
Yes.
Jason, one more time.
Come on, join us at the table.
I'm that poor guy.
Yeah. I'd like to say about Jason in terms of zoning amendments. Jason came in early October, late September, and basically had to hit the ground running on zoning amendments. And we had more this year than in many years. This was the best coordinated effort that I have seen since I've been here. There was time budgeted for three public hearings, if necessary, to work out kinks so that the voters were presented with a better product. And as you can gauge the result from that, all passed. And so, I, in large measure, that was due to Jason's very hard work, not only in learning his clientele, but also in learning New Hampshire law and how that works procedurally. And that was done very well. The goal that I have that I wanted him up here particularly for was to achieve better coordination among boards when it comes to plans and developments that go through
the
planning board.
Yes.
There are a number of steps that involve many other departments and boards than just the planning board itself. And Jason's bringing in a fresh perspective on how that has worked. He's experienced some of the glitches when things don't go well, and I think has certainly the wherewithal and the experience to make things run smoother. And I'd like to see that translated into smoother relations between boards, and I think we can achieve that in this year.
Okay,
with
great.
His help. Can I get a Tinker up here too?
I don't see him.
He's hiding.
These chairs hide a lot of things. Come on up here, Ed.
Thank you.
Give him a phone.
Great job.
Thanks, Jason.
Thank you.
Ed's been back there bad-mouthing us, saying, where am I going to get up
there?
Yeah, I've got been watching them. They're ignoring me.
You're still at 9:30, so this is good.
We in Hampton, like many other communities, are experiencing some large tax abatement cases, especially by utilities. These are costly, sophisticated litigations that involve a lot of outside experts. It involves hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of abatements where large utilities are trying to pay less than the share they're paying now, and the result of that would be that it would fall on the regular taxpayer. I believe the effort is worth the fight. I have to say that I've worked much more closely with Ed than I have with his predecessor in fighting these. We joke that we wear out the carpets between each other's offices. This will be a concerted effort, especially this year. My goal is to get a lot of these large utility cases done this year. Some of them are scheduled for trial in October and November. And because of the court schedule, we're necessarily forced to focus on those. But again, this is an effort where we're trying to handle these in-house as much as possible. It helps accountability because we report direct. Both of us report directly to you folks. If you don't see the information you want, you know where to ask, and we know where to find you. So
let's hear from Ed and see. Well, have you got something that you'd like to as a goal? Or
well, when we've got the reval coming up,
so that's your primary focus.
In the next 18 months or so, we're going to be busy with that, as well as with everything else. I guess my goal is that we are having not so much an issue, but a struggle getting out in the field and picking up, as we talked about, you talked about earlier, all the new construction, all the new development. The cyclical work in itself is one thing, but we saw growth this year, even with the setbacks regarding settlements and pilot agreements, that was substantial. Next year, it appears that it's going to be even more substantial, as well as the fact that we're seeing a larger number of sales take place. Values are changing rapidly in the positive direction. So we're going to see a large change if things stay as they are now. Next year. My big concern is staffing going forward, the ability to be able to get to pick up all of this new construction, be able to go out on a timely basis and review the sales. When the reval is part of the reval, we need to visit all the sales. We've been having a little trouble getting that done. Weather's been an issue, but also based on permits and all the other things going on, it's a struggle. We'll get it done. It's just taking a lot more time than we typically would like to see.
Comments and questions, Mr. Bartle?
Nope, I'm all set.
Mrs. Wesley?
I thought we discussed adding a second part-time position in your office.
We're in the process.
We're doing that?
Trying to do yes.
Yeah, because you definitely need more help. Absolutely.
Mr. Bean?
You're going to be busy, as Esquire has said, and with those challenges and those abatement cases, and you've done magnificent work, and we anticipate you're going to do even better work in the future. Thank you.
Mr. Wardell?
Yeah, I had the pleasure of working with Ed and Mark on one of those settlements, one of those abatements, and it was very pleasurable because I sat there and did nothing, and Mark did a little work, and Ed did a ton of work in there. Negotiating and came out pretty well with the negotiations, so I think he does a great job, and I think it's a benefit to the town.
Appreciate it.
Absolutely. So, thank you for coming in tonight. We appreciate it. We know you have a long ride home, so thank you. And Mark, you're going to stick with us with the committees. So I get there are no more department heads here, right?
Mark, did you leave? Is that your phone or something?
No, that's Max's.
I'm sorry. That's his recording.
So, okay. Now, what committees are we represented here tonight? Because I want you all to join us here at the table so we can have a discussion.
We got energy.
Conservation.
Highway safety.
Highway safety, you've got cable.
We have some QQ there. Does anyone want to take one of these chairs or?
Mosquitoes. And?
We're not allowing any this year.
I got those.
Should we go then?
We're going to give Anna a cookie.
Yeah.
Here, Anna, take this one.
You're going to give me a soft chair. I've been sitting on that. I think you got it.
Well, we want, Jamie, why don't you come up and join us, too, because we're going to be, and Mark also, so that we can make everybody part of this discussion of how we want to go.
Great point.
I'm sorry that you guys all had to wait so long. We really didn't have a agenda for this meeting, but you got to hear some valuable input from the different department heads in that. But one of the things that we're concerned with is, Sunny, did you want to join us up here?
Well, he's fine.
He's not.
That's all right. He's welcome.
Please join us at the table. We would like to have something, a common thread that goes through all these committees, and what are we expecting? What are your missions? How do you conduct your meetings? What about minutes? And what do you do with the minutes?
Agendas.
The agendas. Items to do with websites, things like that. Those are the type of things that we would like to discuss tonight. And let's see here. Ann, you're probably the most experienced committee member here. Why don't we start with
the oldest?
No, I didn't mean that.
Mosquitoes will never go away.
And mosquitoes, Ann's a big favorite with all the town people, yeah, because she's fought hard for the mosquitoes, and I think we all have benefited from
it. Well, mosquitoes are against the mosquitoes.
Yeah. Well,
against.
She works really hard, and her dragon. Dragon mosquito control. A lot of the taxpayers, I hear comment on it a lot. But why don't you tell us how your committee functions?
We meet as required. The first year that I was...
And it's a little hard to hear you, my dear, because you've got such a soft voice.
Oh, I didn't realize we were...
That doesn't go well.
You're being very polite.
Thank you.
The first year I tried having meetings regularly, once a month, and there just wasn't enough material to be covered at that time, and some of the other two oftentimes forget the meeting. So now we just meet as required, as necessary. This will be the last year of a 3-year contract with Dragon Mosquito Control, and one of my concerns is, what is the policy for going out for the RFPs when there are only 2 bidders ever on anything? So that's...
And how do you stay in contact with, for instance, with Fred and bringing your information that you're gathering to the town?
We probably don't do a very good job of that. I receive the reports every month, along with the invoice, which I go over and make sure that everything is right before I sign the invoice and give it to the finance department. Periodically, we have put out notices when, there's been a high uptick of Triple E or West Nile virus mosquitoes. I assume that Fred would ask me if he needs any more information. I know he's a very busy man, so.
She's in the office all the time.
All the time.
We see her all the time.
And I'm running in and out with the finance department and all. Our budget has been flat for the last 4 years. And we're trying to keep it that way, but we never know because it's very petroleum-based. So we do have, you know, I like the fact that people loved mosquito control. Well, there are also people who do not want mosquito control at all. So we do have some who are very much against the use of chemicals of any sort.
And so that was going to be one of the things I was going to bring up about listening to both sides. Mm-hmm. And so do you have a mechanism for your committee to do that?
What we have people do, and they can actually now either call Dragon Mosquito Control or go online. There are two things they can do. They can be put on a do not spray list so that they won't have the truck spraying the chemicals. They will shut the truck off before they get to the property and not turn it on again until they're way out of that property. The people may think that it's still spraying chemicals because there will be mist coming from it, but it's not the chemicals. So it's just the chemical applicator that gets shut off, not the motor itself. The other thing they can do is they can send a request to be notified that day when Dragon Mosquito Control is going to be spraying that route. The town is divided into three routes. Sometimes two routes have to be done the same night because of weather and they haven't been able to be treated for a while. But that's the most that they will do, would be two routes in one night. But they can be put on that list, and I have been put on that list to be notified whenever the truck goes out. So I get the calls, you know, or the emails that the truck is going out that night. But specific routes can be notified so that if they want to make sure their kids aren't out in the street, that the windows are closed, whatever they do. I leave my windows open. I go out and, you know, outside. It doesn't bother me at all, the spray. But there are those people who may be, you know, allergic to it, mm-hmm. sensitive to it, and don't want the spray or to be out in the area where it's being sprayed. So
I think we'll entertain some comments and questions. Mr. Riley.
So you only meet as needed?
Yes.
When do you post your meetings? Yes. And stuff so that people... Mm-hmm.
24 hours before.
Yeah, people. So but somebody that was maybe interested in it, mm-hmm. how can they... Are you on the website? Do you have...
Oh, we post them at the town office and at the library.
Okay.
Places, at least 24 hours in advance.
Okay. And how many people are on your committee?
Three.
And is anybody up this year?
I am.
You are? Okay. I'm just, you know, because we always ask the public out there, and so this is a good time for somebody to find out if it's one of the committees of any of them that they may want to be on. So, but that's good to know. So, thank you.
Yeah.
Yes.
And you and all the committees need to coordinate with the Paw Paquette if you have to, and make sure that the agenda is posted on the website and the minutes of your meetings are posted on the website. I think that's critical because I know the first place I go if I see a meeting or something coming up, I'll go right into the website to see what's going on and how many agendas have been up and what they've been doing through the year. I really think that's important as a public record. And mosquito control does a great job with the public notice, which I think I wrote off a week or two ago. And this has all the details, what do you do if you don't want to buy. This should be on the website, too.
And I believe it is.
I can't remember, right.
I think Paul
I didn't look at everybody's, but that's a great resource right there. You do that every year, so I really appreciate that.
That's one of the requirements. They have to do that.
Mr.
One of my reasons for asking for better oversight of communities is to make sure we're all doing the same thing. And the public really relies on, I think, that website to see what's happening. So we'll look forward to seeing a whole lot about mosquitoes.
Comments, Mr. Bean?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you for your report. And the town report is very informative. You do keep us informed, and Mr. Welch is informed and informs the board. You do a fabulous job, and we expect nothing less than that going forward. Thank you, ma'am.
Mr. Waddell.
Thank you.
Well, we could have even asked Ann to say a little bit about the tax collecting, too, because for anyone that doesn't know, she was the tax collector for how many years?
Well, I was in the tax office for 15 years, 9 years as tax collector, and I was so glad to see that you're going to allow them to round off the bills again, because that was done for several years while I was in the tax office, and then all of a sudden it came to the sense, and that's a great way to make errors on checks.
Yeah. I wanted to ask also, are you looking for more members for your committee, or how do you bring new blood to the committee?
I mean, the way that it was instituted, and by the definition that's in the statutes, was for three-member committee.
Okay.
So that would have to be changed, and I don't know exactly how.
Do you think it works well with the three?
Yeah, I think it could work better. Just because there are, you know, people are busy.
So you would entertain possibly having more members?
I think so.
Okay. Okay, great. Well, this is sort of like a think tank here tonight, so, you know, we're all listening. So let's move on to the energy department. Fresh from Hawaii. Yeah.
Expensive tan, I'll tell you. our meetings are scheduled for the first Thursday of every month. They're held right here. They are televised. I publish an agenda prior to the meeting to our members, which we have four right now. And the agenda also goes to Christina, and it goes to Bill Lowney for the Channel 22. All the minutes are all recorded. The agendas and the minutes are put on the Hampton Energy Committee website, which is linked to the primary website. I can make changes to that, but that's the way it is right now. We are currently working on two projects, and I believe that I'm on your agenda for next Monday to discuss the status of those two projects.
Okay. Now, do you do anything with the website? I mean, you give your minutes to the website, but what about, do you have any other uses for the town website, the Energy Committee?
Not really, because the Energy Committee website is linked directly with the town's website. But I don't really particularly see a need other than, you know, because I work with Rich Hero on our website.
I know Rich.
And, you know, when I'm not in Hawaii, I try to keep it open.
Well,
somebody has to go there.
Dick has, he always works with a lot of, you've been on many different committees and here in town, and we appreciate for all that you do. Now, Walter, who are you here with?
I'm with the Highway Safety Committee.
Ah, that's one we don't hear from too often.
We have a wonderful committee. Larry Douglas,
yeah.
Lieutenant Gidley, and we have the pleasure of Superintendent Noyce, which his retirement has made a void on our committee. I just spoke with Chris Jacobs about how he wanted to handle it, and he said that he'd speak to the town manager, and he would like to serve on the committee also, like Keith did. We just had that discussion out here in the hallway as he was headed home. Our focus is to keep people from public comment coming in front of you complaining about trivial matters that we can correct with Chief Sawyer, Deputy Hobbs, the department, the highway department. And also, when we don't have any complaints, we do an awful lot of talking about worker safety.
How do you invite these complaints from the public?
The public, usually we would get them, Christina will always call me when there's a call to her office.
Linda Stiles would always call me if there was a call to the chief's office at the police station. And if it's a call for a certain intersection, a road, I'll take my beach chair and go and sit and relax and observe, take notes, and I bring my iPad with me, and I take pictures.
Oh, okay.
Okay? And I take pictures. And Assistant Town Manager Sullivan will tell you that we have a great working relationship. We also have a great working relationship with the town manager. Our committee is great. I want to tell you that. It really is a great committee. It's a fun committee. Lieutenant Gidley is a great source because he interprets law. He can tell us about the law. The highway department, I have a lot of stuff from being with the utility for 44 years. I mean, every day in our job was safety. Fred and I get together, and we always battle back and forth from his old days, you know, Donna Wellesley, Power and Light. But safety is paramount. Chris just said to me that Teresa was going to order shirts in the morning. Orange shirts are illegal. The town workers, we can't have our highway guys in orange shirts because drivers mistake orange and think they're hitting a traffic cone when they're hitting a person. So lime green is the color that the federal government mandates. Even though we're a municipality, we don't come under like those rules, but there's a lot of elderly drivers, and there's a lot of drivers that have bad eyes, and they see the orange, and they hit something that's orange, and they've hit a worker, and they think, oh, I just hit a cone. So Chris never knew that, and he just said that, you know, he was glad that I mentioned it to him because they're putting a shirt order in tomorrow. Work boots. Police, fire, and highway. Work boots now have what they call EH, electrical hazard. So if one of the workers is going, let's say a worker is on a jackhammer, highway department, and they bang into a 120-240 secondary underground voltage line, they won't get electrocuted because those boots will protect them up to 600 volts. If we have a police officer who's walking up to a car accident and there's a live wire down in the car and the ground is energized, as soon as they get into that area where they could possibly be electrocuted by foot, their boots will vibrate and warn them to come back out of the area. Constantly, I want to tell you, I have a great relationship with all the sergeants. Deputy Hobbs is wonderful. Everyone at the police department is great. Jamie Arat is a wonderful guy, and we have a great relationship because my son's a captain on the fire department down in Chelmsford. So him and I were always debating safety. And he's the fire prevention officer. Uh-huh. Captain. Very proud of him. I went to York Beach and looked, because I watch faithfully. I went to York Beach to see the crosswalks and everything you raved about.
Kittery.
Yeah, Kittery. Mm-hmm. Federal money.
They're beautiful.
Yeah,
you saw them.
Federal money. And York has done it too.
They've done it also.
Yeah, but it's federal money. Fred, we'll talk to you. We have this conversation all the time because my youngest guy works for GSA. And he's an executive out of the Boston Tip O'Neill building. And he has probably the biggest client municipal of any one on the East Coast. I mean, they're selling police cruisers $22,000. All the federal cars come to Hooks at New Hampshire. But because New Hampshire's a free state,
free stater, we're not signed on with the federal government to purchase equipment, cars, trucks. Because I had asked them, because the deputy, the chief was looking for, to go outside the bid process for the dog truck. Mm-hmm. So on Easter Sunday, I said to him, hey, can you get us a dog truck? He said, I can get you a dog truck. He says, but I can't. He says, I'll probably get it for you cheaper than the town can get it for you, or the state, but he said New Hampshire refuses to get into the federal program. So we do lose a lot of federal funds because of it.
Now, questions and comments, Rusty, for either Dick or Walter?
No, I think both committees have a purpose. I think, we need to look at things like crosswalk safety, crosswalk signage. As we move forward downtown with the businesses down there, looking at making better access to the parking lot and better access to the crosswalks, I think you could probably help them out with that too. I think that's part of what the Highway Safety Committee is supposed to do.
Selectman Rod Allen, in one of the statements he makes a lot of times, he's not a fan of signs.
In the woods.
Of a lot of signs in the woods. Our biggest problem, as far as highway safety, is our own townspeople. The complaints for people speeding are the people who live in the neighborhoods. The complaints for the people who don't stop for people in the crosswalks uptown are the drivers from our town in the off season. A lot of people come in as a tourist on Route 1 and go slow to see and enjoy the town, and they're being beeped at by people in the town who are in a hurry to get the hand of it. So we're our own worst enemies, okay? Because number one, you have to follow the speed limit. I would be embarrassed to be pulled over by a police officer in this town. And I think every one of us should be. I mean, I was reading the RSAs today on alcohol, drinking and driving, OUI, DWI. If you read the RSAs on that, you would never have a drink ever again and get behind the wheel of your car. At a retirement party or a house party.
Thank you. Mrs. Wellesley, do you have any questions for either of those gentlemen?
A couple of odds and ends. Walter, with the Highway Safety Committee, and this, first of all, I'd like to see what you just described to us on the website. Because I think highway safety is, I think there's a heading for highway safety on the website. I confess, I don't know, but if you could put in explanations like that online so the public can become more familiar with what you guys are doing, because you've got some great ideas here. But I think that would help a great deal, because the public says, oh, a bunch of committees. But they don't really stand out as entities, I think, unless we do a little more publicity and do a little more tooting our own horn. And I think it would be good to see a recap from you or the members of the Highway Committee. And the other thing, and I don't know if the members of the Highway Committee have thought this out, but it still really annoys me that there are empty way stations all over the place here, and the state is not manning them. So we have God knows what going up Route 1 for traffic, and we have no idea what's in those trucks. So if you could use your powers of persuasion in Concord, that probably won't do much good, but it's a thought. Dick, I was looking, because you sent us the Energy Committee proposal, so that got me basically looking for you online. I think I only found two agendas in 2 minutes from 2014. Have you guys been posting minutes regularly on the website? Because that's where I go.
Yeah, we're just starting to do that, Mary Louise.
Because we need that.
We got a little lazy about it for a while.
Yeah, because we can't have that.
We're just starting to bring that back.
Your public committees, and where I think everybody's entitled to go on and look and see what the history is, what's
Absolutely.
Been going on. And the other thing, procedurally, I think if committees have a
an issue, and just committees like yours and boards and whoever in town don't always have a bunch of people on them who like each other. So I would hope to have a bit of a standardized process where if there's a disagreement, if someone does something that the other members of the committee are not happy with, whatever, that there could be some kind of little procedure, or you could look to the assistant manager and say, how do we handle this? What do we do? If we could have something, well, Jamie's good at that stuff. If we have some consistency so that if situations arise, and they may from time to time on a committee, that you have a resource and Jamie can help you over the rough spot.
Mr. Bean?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, great work. Appreciate your contribution to the town. Thank you very much.
Mr. Waddell?
Ditto. Thank you.
Okay. And now we're at Jay Diener for the Conservation Commission.
Thank you,
Committee,
Mr. Chairman.
Commission, both.
Commission. We meet monthly on the fourth Tuesday of every month. Our meetings agendas are posted on the town website at Town Hall. I believe also at the library. We are also working with the planning department, with Lori in the planning department, to ask her to include the dates of the Conservation Commission meetings in the letters that go out to abutters of properties who are applying for permits so that they can attend our meetings as well. They don't always know that a person going to the planning board may also be coming to the Conservation Commission until after our meeting has taken place, and we want to give them the opportunity to comment. So we're going to add that to our agenda. We also do post our minutes after our meeting again at Town Hall and on our website. And we do that faithfully and regularly.
On the town website?
Yes. Well, on the Conservation Commission page, on the town website, as well as on the agendas and minutes page.
What we're getting here is some information, and we're going to, try to have a standard for all the committees, and I think that's what we're doing here tonight. I apologize to everybody that we really didn't know what was going to be, how this was going to unfold tonight, but you all got to hear a lot of information, and we're hearing information. Mr. Bridle, do you have questions for Jay?
No, I think he brings that on many committees, not just the Conservation Committee. He brings a lot forward. Jay, are there any openings on your committee right now? Do you know of?
We're slated to have up to 7 full commissioners. We have 6 currently. I've been speaking to some of our alternates to try to assess who might be ready to move up to a full position.
So if anybody out in the public was interested in becoming on the Conservation Committee, they should send you a note?
Get in touch with me or get in touch with Rayanne, by all means. We're always looking for more people. The current members of the committee are always talking to people in town to find out who might have an interest in joining us. We are limited by RSA to 7 full members, but we don't have a limit as to the number of alternates that we can have.
So is that sort of the customary way to become a member, is to become an alternate? Would you say?
Generally speaking, yes. It gives people the opportunity to see how we work, to learn what the ordinances are, to get a better feel for what the issues are that we deal with. So it's a way to ease into the commission. So, yes, it does tend to work better that way.
Mrs. Woolsey?
Great job.
Mr. Bean?
No, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you,
Mr. Waddell.
Thank you. Do a good job.
Thank now you. We got Brian just sitting there waiting.
Waiting. Turn the lights on. We have meetings as needed. We do post the agenda. Whether we put it on the website, I'm not sure. I will look into that. And our minutes are, I believe, behind by a few meetings, and I will look into that. We are a working committee, meaning that we are a committee, but we also run the equipment. There's a lot of towns. The committee is a committee, and they dictate to a working staff. So, I mean, that's why we don't have meetings every month, because it's difficult to get everybody together where there's not a meeting going on and not something that needs to be televised or filmed. And so we do it as necessary.
But your committee is kind of unique because there are paid members.
Yes, they're stipend. They get paid a stipend. Yes.
Oh,
technicians.
Technicians. Okay.
But are the technicians necessarily members of the committee?
No. No, we have committee members, and we have technicians that come in and do the meetings and you know, whatever else is needed to be delivered down the street.
And how do you decide about bringing more technicians in?
As needed. We have the committee, which most of us are active in working. And then we have, I think we have three technicians that are working every meeting or every their shift. And then we have two or three that are on call, that we can call if we need. Only one is Mike Swan, so he's now helping out. So.
Questions? Mr. Bartle?
No, all set. Thank you.
Mrs. Wesley?
Good job, Brian.
Mr. Bean?
Good job.
I'm the representative on that committee from the selectmen, and they do a really good job. And if they're behind in the minutes or they're behind in their agenda, there's a reason why that is, because they, you know, I mean, lots of times you'll see Brian over here during the day when he should be at his place working and doing a lot of work here. So, I mean, they do a great job with what they have, and they make sure that they keep things running very smoothly, and when we do have a breakdown like we did a couple of months ago or something, you know, they're right there, bang, 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 trying to knock it out so we get it on. I mean, it's on the website very nicely, and I think they really should be commended for what they do with the resources that they have. So, it's good job.
Thank you.
I thought you could type fast, Brian.
Well, I think that, so I'd like to get a consensus of the board of, you know, what do you think would it be fair to ask Mark and Jamie to come up with some
draft guidelines for committees?
For the committees, what do you think about that, Mr.
Yeah, no, that's fine.
I think what I'm hearing from the board is you probably want an updated list of what committees you have, how many members, what openings, and what are their goals and tasks, and then kind of work with them to those that have the gaps that we've heard tonight about minutes and agendas, and we'll try and find some solutions for you.
But and uses of the town website, things like that. You know, I think that that's kind of important. Do you have comments, Mr. Reynolds? This is Wesley.
This is overdue.
I just thank all the committees. I mean, you know, these are people volunteering for the town.
Yeah.
All the people that are on their committees volunteering. You know, they're doing a good job. And, you know, thank you. And if you follow down a little bit.
Just one note on the crosswalks. I want to, John Kane from the Village District has made it a point that it's on the website for the Village District for people who come, you know, state law is to stop the pedestrians in the crosswalks,
right.
But it's on both websites for the district, but it's not on the town website.
And Sonny, as a member of the public that's been here all evening, do you have any comments?
No, I think it's encouraged by what I'm hearing.
Yeah.
All of you have a phone number where we can tell you where the potholes are?
I think he's going to refer that one to another agency.
Exeter Road, High Street, Cusack Road.
It's important that we have some firm guidelines.
Sonny was one of the people that, you know, and his wife mentioned about having guidelines and brought it to attention, and everybody, it's been something we've been talking about here. So we appreciate everybody came here tonight, and if you have further input that you'd like to bring to Mr. Sullivan or Mr. Gerald, I'm sure they would welcome it. If you can think of something that hasn't been said here tonight, we appreciate everybody's service and enthusiasm.
Thank you.
You're all, I mean, Walter's been, he's on the Hampton Area Commission, too. Florida won out over that one, though.
Oh, well, I did 2 months in Curacao, so I missed your turn.
But we appreciate you, all of you. So thank you for coming in tonight.
Thank you.
Final closing comments for our members here?
No, I think this is a good way to, we've heard a lot of good conversation tonight. We've got some guidelines about what our department heads are looking at, what they're looking forward, and
I think we're going to move forward, so.
Mrs. Wellesley?
I will move.
We're having closing comments about, do you have any comments about tonight's meeting?
Very nice.
Mr. Bean?
It was fabulous, Mr. Chairman. Thanks for sponsoring it.
And Mr. Wardell?
Excellent.
Okay, so what about...
I'm not to adjourn, but I'm going
to... I'm not quite ready yet.
Oh, you're not done.
No, I was going to say that our closing comments here as the board, we're asking Mr. Sullivan to come up with some guidelines for these committees. And I think Mr. Welch has, if it's okay with the other members of the board, he's listened to everything that's been said here tonight. And you can maybe come up with a synopsis of our goals.
Yeah.
And we'll go when you get them all written down, we'll discuss them again during one of our regular meetings, if that's okay with everybody.
It was said good and properly.
Okay. Does someone want to make a motion?
I move we adjourn. Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you.
You need your time for the record.
You should call for all those opposed. This should be a short vote.
All those opposed to adjourn?
Yeah.